Hey, I'm Ryan, and welcome to Nest Hacker. In this episode, we'll break open this NES game, and I'll show you what's going on inside. So, this is the first video in a series on ROM hacking. And it's my intention to start with the very basics and build up from there. For the uninitiated, a ROM hack is effectively a modification to a classic game. Often, the goal is to add custom graphics, enhance the gameplay, or to fix bugs that weren't addressed by the original developers. We'll be using the classic Nintendo Entertainment System as our console of choice when it comes to ROM hacking. For this first episode, I'll be explaining the basics of what's going on inside this Super Mario Bros. Duck Hunt cart. Everybody's got a different level of experience when it comes to hacking, so if you have a question or think I made an error on a technical point, by all means, let me know in the comments. All right, before we proceed, do me a favor and subscribe to the channel, then hit the like button while I go over a few points of caution. First, static electricity can cause damage to the electronic components inside of a game cart. Before you open a cart and start poking around, I suggest you touch something like a doorknob to ensure you're not carrying a charge. Second, try your best to avoid touching the contacts on the bottom of the PCB, as oil from your skin can combine with the metal and lead to corrosion, potentially making the game unplayable. Finally, the printed circuit boards inside the case can sometimes have sharp edges. I've never been cut, but it's probably better to be safe than sorry. Bottom line is, you're hacking your carts at your own risk. Okay, let's open the cart. On the back of the cart, you'll encounter three hexagonal security screws. You'll need a special screwdriver bit to remove them. So I added an Amazon link in the description if you want to buy your own. Equipped with the correct bit, use your driver to fully loosen but don't fully remove each of the screws. Then, gently pull up on the lip at the bottom of the case. This should raise the bottom portion of the back half, kind of pivoting at the top. Ensure all three screws are free from their holes. You might have to jiggle it a little. And then gently pull until the back of the case comes free. To make things easier for reassembly, keep the screws in their respective holes and place the back half of the case somewhere secure. This should expose the game's printed circuit board. Grab it carefully by the sides, lift it out, and move the front of the case out of the way. Finally, flip it over to reveal the components on the board. Upon closer inspection of the board, we notice a few major features. The most prominent are two large integrated circuits, two smaller integrated circuits, and various labels printed on the board itself. Of particular interest to us are the PRG ROM, CHR ROM, NES MH ROM 02, and CIC labels. PRG ROM is shorthand for Program ROM chip, and denotes the rough position for the physical chip on the board. The program ROM chip contains the actual machine code for the game, or in this case, games. Machine code is a binary representation of the program that can be read by the NES console's hardware and used to generate the interactions for the game. The zeros and ones that represent how high Mario can jump or how fast a Koopa shell can slide are physically encoded into the silicon of this read-only memory chip. You can find a program ROM chip on any NES game, as it's literally required for the cartridge to contain a game. CHR ROM is shorthand for character ROM chip, and, in a similar way to the program ROM label, denotes the rough position for the chip on the board. For NES games, the character ROM chip usually contains the sprite images for the game. For this game in particular, it has the sprites for things like Mario, Goombas, and the dog in Duck Hunt. Now, where every game has a program ROM, not every game has a character ROM. Some games like The Legend of Zelda store their program and graphics on the program ROM and then load their graphics into special memory banks while the game is running. We're not going to cover all the different ways that Nintendo games can store their data in this video, but be aware that different games do use different techniques. The NES MH-ROM-02 label tells us the model number for the board itself. Nintendo produced a wide variety of board types for use with their licensed games, each with its own characteristics. This label tells us that this is an MH-ROM board type, which supports up to 64 kilobytes of program ROM and 32 kilobytes of character ROM memory. The MH-ROM label also indicates to us how the LR74HC161 chip is being used on the board. That's a common digital logic chip, and in this case, it's being used as what we call a mapper. Now, the NES can only access so much memory at once due to limitations of the console's hardware. To get around this, programmers can segment one big game into smaller chunks called banks. They can then program the game to interact with the mapper hardware on the board to switch which banks of memory are active while the game is running. Mapper logic can differ from game to game, usually based on what board the game is using. The details for a particular game are pretty important when you're working on a ROM hacking project, so we'll be discussing the different types of mappers as they come up and explaining how they work. Finally, let's talk about that 6113A chip labeled CIC on the left side of the board. That's called the CIC lockout chip, and it was used to make it harder for third-party publishers to create games that weren't officially licensed by Nintendo. Without that chip, or at least one that mimicked that chip's behavior, a game will not correctly play when slotted into an NES. The CIC chip is a whole topic unto itself, and it's way outside the scope of this video. For those who are curious, I've left some links to further information about its history and operation in the description. Alright, in this episode, we showed how to open an NES game, identify some of the components on the inside, and explained a bit about what each of those components does. In the next video of this series, we'll explain how one goes from a physical ROM cartridge to a ROM file that we can start hacking. Thanks for watching NES Hacker. If you enjoyed the video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. If you hit the bell icon, you'll be notified when I release the next video on the channel. And if you have any questions or feedback, let me know in the comments.